بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وعلى من تبع هداهم إلى يوم الدين. After praising Allah, the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, and passing salutation upon His Messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. We will start straight away with the Sahaba radiallahu anhum wa ardahum. And before I start with the new companion, I would like just to address a question that's been asked to me by, I think, Abdul Qadir, what is he? And he was asking me regarding a hadith which is mentioned in your book, which is regarding Salman al-Farisi, Salman minna al-Bayt. And one of the brothers here had pointed out for me that this hadith is to be unauthentic. And a correction here, it is unauthentic, but as the meaning of it, it's 100% sound. Meaning that the Prophet of Allah did not say Salman minna al-Bayt, but definitely Ali ibn Abi Talib had said it, and also Abdullah ibn Salam had said it, and it's been confirmed as in the meaning of it is sound, but the hadith in itself is not authentic. You'll find that discussion in the Silsila al-Da'ifa of Sheikh al-Albani 3704 underneath which the Sheikh discusses the issue of the hadith Salman min al-Bayt. But as I said, this hadith is to be mawqufun ali and is correct. And also Abdullah ibn Salam, he had said it, radiallahu anhu warda. And there was others as well who had said it, but I'm just saying mainly Ali ibn Abi Talib and Salman and Abdullah ibn Salam. Amr ibn al-As. Amr ibn al-As, radiallahu anhu warda. In terms of, first of all, his name and his lineage, he is Amr ibn al-As ibn Wa'il al-Qurashi al-Sahmi. Amr ibn al-As al-Qurashi al-Sahmi. And he is Abu Abdullah, and it's been said that he's Abu Muhammad. His mother, she's called An-Nabira, and the subtitle, or her name is Salma. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had appointed him to lead the army that was going and heading towards Dhatus Salasil, and in which, radiallahu anhu warda, he had led them, and one night he was on Janaba. He had a wet dream. So, and it was a cold night. So he did not wash because it was a cold weather and cold water. So he remembered the saying of the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا. And don't kill yourselves, for verily Allah is merciful to you. So I made tayammum, and I led the companions. And the companions, after which they told the Prophet of Allah later on that Amr ibn al-As led us while he was on tayammum, and because he had janaba and he had water, but the water he did not use it. So the Prophet of Allah asked him, Amr, why did you do that? So the Messenger of Allah, it was cold night, and they remembered Allah said, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا. Verily Allah said, don't kill yourself, for verily Allah is merciful to you. And that is why I thought that it will not be safe for me to go and have a ghusl with water. And I used the tayammum and I led them in prayer. That is the Fajr prayer. The Prophet of Allah smiled upon that. He lived in Medina, and then also he later on he moved to Egypt and he died in it. Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he made him to lead an army that is to go to conquer Masr, Egypt. So he had opened Egypt, Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu. So we call it Amr, or Misr of Amr, the Misr that belongs to Amr ibn al-As. And later on, he left Egypt and then appointed again at the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu. And Uthman later on took him away from the leadership. Then when Uthman radiallahu anhu died and was killed, he went to Mu'awiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. So he was on the side of Mu'awiyah ibn Sufyan, not on the side of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. And he was involved in the famous arbitration that took place between Muawiyah and Ali radiallahu anhuma. Muawiyah, he had Amr ibn al-As as the arbitrator, and from Ali ibn Abi Talib, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu al-jami'. As I said, Amr ibn al-As, he has a fascinating life. Let's just start first of all talking about he becoming a Muslim. Before he went, became a Muslim, Amr ibn al-As is a story with his father. His father is actually, he had married to his mother, and she was before, she was a Sabiyya, meaning she was a slave, a war booty. And he was chosen by the people of Quraysh to be a delegate, to be sent to Abyssinian leader Ashama in order to bring back those companions who migrated at the beginning. If you remember with me, Prophet of Allah gave permission to the companions to migrate to Abyssinia because of the torture and the persecution that took place. So they left, and one of them, Ja'far ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, others like Abu Salama, Salama, and they stayed with Ashama. So the people of Quraysh didn't like that. They sent Amr ibn al-As in order to negotiate with the king of Habasha to bring them back. And they sent with them, with him, Abdullah ibn Abi Rabi'ah, both. And both, by the way, became Muslim later on. And they sent with them as well a number of gifts in order, just like to soften the heart of the king, in order to bring back those Muslims. So the people of Quraysh wanted those who migrated back, to return back to where? To Mecca. So, radiallahu anhu ardaah, Amr al-As, he said when he went there, he brought with him some skins of animals, tanned skins, and the king at that time used to love the tanned skins. When he arrived there, him and Abdullah, they met those of commanders close to the king, and they told him, tomorrow we're going to meet your king. And verily, as soon as we talked to him, and we told him that we, the Arabs, had some people left us, and they're at the moment speaking ill about our guards, and we need them to return back, for verily their families, they know better than the king about them and about the situation. All we wanted just to confirm. And they gave them as well their gifts, like a bribe. So they accepted. The following day, they came to the king and told him that they need these people. So he said, I'm not going to hand you these people because they chose me for my protection, and I will not hand them in until I will know what is the story. So he brought them, and the companions conferred with one another, and they made Ja'far ibn Abi Talib to speak on their behalf. And Ja'far ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, he decided along with the companions to say what the Prophet told them and taught them. So he told the king that we were people of paganism, worshipping idols, eating the carrion, the dead animals, and making fornications, and doing all sorts of things, devouring the wealth of the orphan, and using untaken riba, and usury, and all of that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought us a man amongst us. We know his chastity, and we know that he's truthful. So he commanded us not to worship the idols, but to worship Allah alone, and to stop fornication, and not to lie, and to be truthful, to be good to our neighbors, and all of that. And our people, they didn't like this, so they started torturing us. And the Prophet of Allah, he told us to go to yourself, because he said that you are a king who does have no oppression, no dhulm. So we chose your land beside other lands, and we came to you. So Then he said to him, what do you say? So he told Amr ibn al-As, is I'm going to hand them back again. But Amr ibn al-As, he said, I'm going to tell him something the following day in which a king will uproot them. And he told the king that they say something regarding Isa alayhi salam, which is something blaspheme, that he's a slave. So he summoned them again, and then Amr al-As recited the beginning of Surah Maryam, Kafaya Ayn Sad, Dhikru, and to the end, and he mentioned how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created Isa alayhi salam, and by the time that he had finished, the king himself, he had drenched his beard with tears. Not only that, those priests who were at the time spreading their scrolls, which is the Bibles, they themselves were crying. And we believe that the verse that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said that تَجِدَنَّ أَشَدَّ النَّاسِ عَدَاوَةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الْيَهُودَ وَالَّذِينَ أَشْرَكُوا وَلَتَجِدَنَّ أَقْرَبَهُمْ مَوَدَّةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّا نَصَارَى. This verse, Allah revealed it regarding al-Najashi, whom those people, when they recite Quran to them, you'll find them, their hearts are softened, and they will be as well in tears. So, he picked up a piece of wood, Najashi, and he said, verily, whatever came to Prophet Musa and Prophet Muhammad has no difference. Whatever we believe and whatever you believe regarding Isa alayhi salam, it does not exceed the thickness of that wooden stick. And he said, verily by the one who created myself, that whatever came to Muhammad and came to Musa comes from one source. Go into my land, you have a protection. So, and he told Amr ibn al-As and Abdullah ibn Abi Rabi'ah to go back with nothing, an empty handed. So there was a friendship between al-Najashi and Amr ibn al-As. Al-Najashi is a believer. So here, Amr ibn al-As, he says that when we left the Battle of the Trench, and was the Battle of the Trench in which the Confederates, the Allies, were defeated so badly. And the opponent was Allah, the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the one who sent in the gusting wind and all of that, and he uprooted their tents and the cold night. The fire was extinguished, left nothing left for them. So after that, he said, I have gathered some people of Quraysh, Amr ibn al-As. And they used to reckon that I'm a person who is a leader amongst them. They used to listen to me. I said to them that you know for a fact that the matter of the affairs of Muhammad is going high and high at the moment. That means his reputation, his power is increasing. And I have thought of an idea. They said, what is that? He said, I have thought that we should go and catch up with al-Najashi, and we stay with him. If Muhammad is to win against our people, then we will be with al-Najashi, and it's better to be under the Najashi rather than to be under the control of Muhammad. And if our people is to win over Muhammad, then our people will never forget what we are. I mean, they will not forget our relationship to them. So they will not really harm us, and they will accept us to go back to them. They said, this is a good opinion. So he said, let's just go ahead and gather as much as we can from the presents, meaning the skins, the tan skins, because the king, he likes them. And we went to al-Najashi. Najashi, as I said, he's a friend. While he was there, Prophet of Allah already had sent a person called Amr ibn Umayyah al-Dhimri, radiallahu anhu, in order to negotiate with the king to send back Ja'far ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu and those who migrated to Abyssinia, because those who migrated to Abyssinia, they missed the migration from Mecca to Medina. They were not along with the Prophet when he migrated. They stayed with the king and with the Abyssinians there in their land. So the Prophet of Allah, he sent for them when he was now established a state in Medina to send them back. So Amr ibn Umayyah ibn al-Dhimri was at the time there, and also the time Amr ibn al-As was there. So Amr ibn Umayyah al-Dhimri, he left, and then I said to my friends, Amr ibn al-As, he said, this is Amr ibn Umayyah. I think if I just go to the Najashi and ask him for the permission to hand him over to me, then I will kill him. And if I kill him, then Quraysh, they will know that I have done them a favor. And they will never forget this upper hand that I've given them when I killed the messenger of Muhammad. So I went inside and I prostrated like I used to prostrate to Al-Najashi. You see, kings, you see, at that time, whenever somebody comes to them, he prostrated. So I asked him. That is, I said to him, and as soon as he came in, even the king, he said to him, Marhaban bis sadiq, welcome to the friend. So he knows him very well. And then he said, I brought you some lots of, you know, udum. And even the king is asking, did you bring something? He's like, he's keen to have those skins which are from the Arabs' lands. He said, yes. So he liked it. Now this is like to elucidate for what he wants to say. He said to him, very dear, O king, I have seen a man just karar from your presence now. He left. And he is the messenger of a man who is an enemy for us. Give him to me, hand him over to me so I could kill him. For verily he had this man, which is Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he had done lots of things against our leaders and our best. So he was really enraged, the king. And he stretched his hand and he struck his nose with a strike that he thought, I almost thought that he broke his nose. He struck his face like this onto his nose. He thought, I thought he broke his nose. And verily, if the earth was to be split open and I could go inside it in order just to be away from him because I was scared. What is he going to do to me? Because the way he's done it, he said, I've had it. Then I said, oh king, it looks like you hated what I've said. And you hated what I have requested you. He said, are you requesting from me to give you the messenger of a man? Messenger, that means Amr ibn Maitab. Of a man, that means Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The messenger of a man, whom the Namusul Akbar. Namusul Akbar is a name being given by the Christian to Jibreel alayhi salam. Revelation. And Namusul Akbar, the revelation, comes to him, which is the same Namus used to come to Musa. I'm going to hand him over to you to kill him. He said, Amr ibn al-As, king, is it true? I mean, is it the case? He said, Amr, what are you doing here? For verily, obey me and follow him. I mean, listen to what I'm saying to you. Follow him. For he is upon haqq. And Allah will make him to prevail against who had opposed him. Just like Allah made Musa alayhi salam to prevail against Fir'aun and his soldiers. And that tells you clearly that Najashi is a Muslim. So if he's telling him that, he's a Muslim. And I'll tell you more than that. So I said to him, that is Amr al-Asim, I said to the king, okay, can you accept my pledge for Islam? And that is why some of the scholars, they said that he had already accepted Islam on the hand of As'amah. So As'amah is not just a Muslim, he's a Da'iyah. He's calling to Islam. So he said, yes, okay. So the king, he stretched his hand, Amr al-As, he held his hand, and he said, I have given him the pledge that I became a Muslim. So you can't give a pledge that you became a Muslim to someone who's not a Muslim, can you? He has to be a Muslim in order to accept your pledge for Islam. So then I left with my friends, and I did not tell them what I'm already on. That means I'm a Muslim. I've hidden my Islam from them. Then I went straight away, heading towards the Prophet ﷺ. And I, on the way, I met Khalid ibn Walid. And that was just about before the conquest or the repossession of Mecca. Some scholars, they said, it's about 6 months before that, before the repossession of Mecca. And he was coming from Mecca and he was heading towards the Medina. So I said, Abu Sulaiman, this is Khalid ibn Walid. And by the way, his biography will be inshallah following next week. Khalid ibn Walid, Abu Sulaiman, where are you heading? He said, verily, the path is clear now. The man is a prophet. I'm going to go to embrace Islam. Enough is enough. Until when? We're going to be just waiting. So he said, by Allah, I came as well to embrace Islam and to as well to give the pledge. So they went together to the Prophet ﷺ. Khalid Walid, he was first. And the Prophet of Allah stretched his hand, Khalid, he grabbed his hand and he had given in the pledge onto Islam. Then I got closer. And then I saw the Prophet of Allah stretching his hand. So I pulled my hand away. I said, "What's wrong, Ya Am?" Prophet of Allah is asking me. He said, "Messenger of Allah, before I give you the pledge, there's a condition." "What condition?" He said, "Allah would forgive my previous sins." It looks like he'd done a lot. my previous sins. So he's scared. He's the thing that he's worried about is his sins. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, "Don't you know, Ya Amr? Al-Islam yajubu ma qabla." Islam, it will expiate what had preceded it. And also he said, "Al-bay'atu tajubu ma qabla." The hijrah, the migration, it will expiate what is as well preceded it. So here the Prophet ﷺ is calming Amr ibn As. And also we have a third one. Is which one? Hajj will expiate everything before it. So, Ya Amr, bay'a. Go on, give the pledge. So he gave the pledge, and I gave him the pledge and I left. SubhanAllah. The Prophet ﷺ, when he had given him the pledge and he accepted Islam, Amr ibn As, he felt that, you know, that he is a newly born person. And all that hatred that it was towards the Prophet of Allah, it turned into exactly the same in power, but in love. All that hatred and dislike, it turned into what? Love. Same power. And that reminds me of the story of Thumama ibn Uthal. Thumama is the Sayyidul Yamama. The Prophet ﷺ sent some men towards Najd. And on their way, they met this man, and he was a kafir. So they captured him, and he was, as I said, the chief, the head of Al-Yamama. And they brought him to the Prophet ﷺ, and they put him into the masjid, tied him up to the column. And the Prophet of Allah passed by him, and he said, "Ya Thumama, ma indak?" "What do you have?" He said, "Oh Muhammad, in tukrim," that means if you forgive, you're going to forgive for someone who's not going to forgive, forget your favor. In tukrim, so Allah Azza wa Jal will, so I will not forgive your favor. And if you're going to kill, innaka taqtulu dhadan, you're going to be killing someone who has people who will ask for his blood. Okay? And if you want money, you ask and I'll give you whatever you like. He said, "Anything else, Thumama?" "Nothing else." So he left him. He's tied up. Following day, he asked him the same. "Yeah, Thumama, what do you have?" "Well, if you kill someone who has got people who are going to ask for his blood. And if you want to forgive and pardon, then you pardon upon someone who will never forget your favor. And if you want to ask money, then ask whatever you like and I'll give you." He left the third day. Asked him the same thing. And he gave the same reply. And he left him. Then Thumama, after the third day, after that, the Prophet of Allah said to the companion, "Set him free." So as soon as Thumama was set free, he went to the outside, to the water. And he had a ghusl. And then he came back and he said, "Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu annaka rasulullah." I'm asking, is it just because he forgave him, pardoned him? He just, "Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah." He's just like, for example, first time I should have forgiven. Is that because of that? I don't think so. It's an accumulation of 3 days' work. Okay? 3 days' work. And those 3 days' work, it started with the masjid, because he's here listening to the recitation. 5 daily prayers, especially the ones which are loud recitation. Maghrib and Isha and Fajr. Those are very powerful in their impact onto the heart. Plus, he saw the companions' love with each other, the companions' respect to the Prophet. He sees lots of things. The masjid is the best of places. We're not going to be locking prisoners of war in there, but the best of place to bring, you know, iman to the heart of a person, make da'wah. And then he said to the Prophet, "O Messenger of Allah, verily your face was the most hated face of my heart, and verily now it is the most beloved face of my heart. O Prophet of Allah, Verily, your deen, your religion, was the most hated religion to my heart. Now it is the best religion to my heart. Oh, Prophet of Allah, your place, your area, your city was the most hated place to me. Now it's the most beloved to my heart. Messenger of Allah, your cavaliers had caught me while I was making Umrah. He was making Umrah even as a cavalier. If you wish, do you think that it's better for me to go and make the Umrah? See, he gave him a glad tiling. Basharahu Rasulullah Sallam. Go ahead and give the Umrah. He went to the Umrah. As soon as he went there, already his news of embracing Islam had preceded him. People of Quraysh said to him, Sabat, kafart, I mean, they disbelieved. He said, no, I Islamed, I believed. You are the kuffar, I'm not the kuffar. Sabat, you full of that man? As soon as he said that word, he said, okay, Sabat, okay, that means you don't like the Prophet Muhammad. By Allah, you're not going to get a piece of wheat from Yamama until the Prophet of Allah gives the permission for it. Yeah. What are you going to do now? So it's an economical sort of sanction onto him. Right. From the Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, Amr ibn al-As also from his virtues, that the Prophet of Allah testified for him that he is on Iman. Abu Hurairah, he said, the Messenger of Allah, he said, the sons of As, the two of them, they are believers, Amr and Hisham. Also the Prophet of Allah, he said, people had embraced Islam, but Amr, he entered the Iman. So that's even more. And from his virtues, his love to Islam, and his also keenness, and his eagerness to become, or to come close to the Prophet of Allah. Amr ibn al-As, he said, the Messenger of Allah sent for me, and he said to me, take your clothes and your weapons on you, for verily, I'm going to send you to a expedition, and Allah Azza wa Jal, we're going to make you rich with a bull booty. And then I will give you some of that portion. So he said, Messenger of Allah, I did not embrace Islam for the money. I embraced Islam because I wanted Islam. And I wanted to be with the Prophet of Allah. He said, yeah, Amr, good money, righteous good money, is good for the righteous good man. And that hadith, we explained it thoroughly in work. Yeah, Shakir? Where? Explain that in Mufra. Ya Amr, نعم المال الصالح للرجل الصالح. Good money is good for good person, righteous person. That means if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you money, don't throw it away and say, I don't want money. That money is good. Allah gave you the money for the salah. And if the person, he has money and uses it in the right way, that's a very good thing. Alhamdulillah. The money, if you are not really asking for it and it came to you, that's alhamdulillah, that's a blessing. So if somebody had given you halal gift money and you did not ask for it, you did not really look for it, and it just came to you, then accept it like Umar al-Khattab, when the Prophet of Allah sent him some portion of money. And then the Umar al-Khattab, he said, Messenger of Allah, why do I have to have this? He said, Ya Umar. He said, Oh Umar, if that money came to you without you asking, وَلَمْ تَتَشَوَّفْ لَهُ نَفْسُ You're not really eager to have it, then accept it. So any money comes to you, accept it. So Umar al-Khattab, he said, since that day, if any money comes to me without me asking for it, I will take it. I will not return it. It's halal, alhamdulillah. نِعْمَ الرَّجُلُ نِعْمَ الْمَالُ الصَّالِحِ الرَّجُلِ الصَّالِحِ From his virtues as well, that he was very strong in holding onto the sunnah of the Prophet of Allah, and also implementing what he had learned from the Messenger of Allah. Number one example, Amr al-As one day, he heard a man reciting a verse. He said, who had made you to recite it in this following way? He said, the Messenger of Allah. He said, well, the Messenger of Allah made me to recite it in a different way. So they went to the Prophet of Allah. One of them said, Messenger of Allah, such and such verse, so and so, that means ayah, that means the number so and so. And then he recited it. The Prophet of Allah, he said, this is the way it's been revealed. The other one, which is Amr al-As, he said, okay, Messenger of Allah, this is the verse, and he recited it in his way. He said, this is the way it's been revealed. Then the Prophet of Allah, he said, the Qur'an was revealed into seven letters, سَبْعَةُ أَحْرَفٍ any letter that you recite from it, then you have been correct. And do not dispute in the Quran. For verily disputing into the Quran is kufr, or as a sign of a kufr. Who is the other person who also had a dispute with one of the companions regarding the station? Yes? Umar al-Khattab. But what did Umar al-Khattab do? Huh? He did what? He grabbed him like this. No, Umar al-Khattab didn't do that. Well, he grabbed him like this and he dragged him to the Prophet of Allah. What are you doing? It's Quran, you're playing around with it? And the Prophet said, let go of him. Let go of him. Because he couldn't recite while he's being grabbed. He's going to be choked. Let go of him. He started reciting. He said, this is the way. Oh, Umar, reciting yourself. This is the way. So both are correct. So if you have listened or heard somebody reciting the Quran or a verse that you have memorized in a different way, don't jump to the conclusion right and say nothing wrong. Okay? Don't jump to the conclusion you something wrong. One of the people telling me that he was behind someone and he was reciting a riwayah from Hafs. And he was reciting the surah, which is everybody memorize it. تبت يدا أبي لهب وتب ما أغنى عنه ماله وما كسب سيصلى نارا ذات لهب وامرأته. Instead of حمالة, he said حمالة الحطب. So he said حمالة. So he didn't listen to him and he finished. And everybody is telling him, what is حمالة? He said, this is the recitation. And it's from the Quran. So if you didn't know, if you are a jahil, please don't at least object. You could ask. I've heard you saying Hammalatul Hatam. I want to know, is it a mistake or not? Just like the companions, where they prayed in Asr all their life, since they were taught by the Prophet of Allah four rak'ah. Prophet of Allah prayed it one day. How many? Two rak'ah. So some of the companions went quiet. Because maybe they, well, it's been changed now. It's been four to two rak'ah. It's a revelation. Cut short. And then there's some of the companions left. Oh, khalas, four, two left. And someone went quiet, want to know what is happening. And others, Abu Dhul Yadayn, the one with the 200 zakat, Dhul Yadayn, he came to the Prophet of Allah and he said to the Messenger of Allah, did you forget what is the revelation? He said, neither this nor that. He said, yes, Messenger of Allah. He looked at the companion, yes, Messenger of Allah, he forgot. Then he made the two rak'ah. So don't jump to the conclusion. Always ask better than to say you made it wrong, because you could be wrong. Seven ahraf, sab'atu ahraf. And if you want to start to explain what is sab'atu ahraf, that's a different lecture. So please don't ask that question. Okay? But there is lahajat. And now at the moment, because we have 40 sayings regarding the word sab'atu ahraf, different opinions. But we know that now we have 10 authentic recitations. There are 14, 4 of them are shadh, and 10 are correct. And those qira'at, they're linked to the ahraf, but they're not the ahraf. Coming back. Amr ibn al-As, one day he came to Fatima. Fatima went to Muhammad, sallam, the wife of Ali, Abi Talib. So he knocked and she gave him permission to come in. So he said, is Ali there? She said, no. He left. Following me, came. She gave him permission. Is Ali there? He said, no. He left. Third day, he came. He knocked. Is Ali there? She said, yes. So he entered. So Ali, he said, radiallahu anhu, why didn't you come first and second time when you came the last time? He said, the Prophet of Allah, he forbade us to come onto the mughibat, meaning onto the women whom their husband is not there. Whom the women whom their husband is not there. So for those who come inside the house on their own, if it's with your wife, that's understandable. Because your wife, you want to see the wife and you go to a different room. You on your own, you go to a woman. Even if you've got children, those young children, where her husband is not there, fear Allah. And especially the relative, because he got more access. Especially the neighbor, and especially as well the brother of the husband, which we call him the ham. Al-hamul maut. It had destroyed lots of houses because of that. The husband started to doubt his brother. And as I said, it will bring disaster and destruction. Be careful. إِيَّاكُمْ الدُّخُولَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ Prophet ﷺ, he said, be aware on entering on the woman. That means on their own, without a mahram, or without any somebody else with you. Messenger of Allah, what about the brother of the husband? He said, he is death. Meaning he will cause death and disaster. From his virtues as well, is to enjoin good and forbid evil. And he was eager to do that. One day, a man came along with his son, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. He entered upon his father. So, his father, he brought food and he said, eat. The man who was along with Abdullah said, I'm fasting. And those days were the days of Tashriq. The following 3 days after Eid al-Adha. After Eid al-Adha, the 3 days where the Prophet of Allah said, Ayyamu aklin wa shurb. The days of food and drink and celebration. So he said to him, eat. For those days, Prophet of Allah used to command us to break our fast and used to forbid us from fasting then. Eat. So he commanded them to eat. And also he said one day on the pulpit, oh people, and he's addressing the followers, not the companions, for verily, your path so far away from the path of the Prophet. Your sunnah that you are on, it is not the sunnah of your Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As for him, Prophet of Allah, he is to be the most ascetic regarding the dunya. As for you, you are keen to ask for it. That means you are after dunya. Prophet of Allah is all after the deen, not the dunya. He is ascetic. For verily, he said, by Allah, not a single day had passed, except that the Prophet of Allah has more debt than what he can pay. Do you understand that? Every day that passed, he said, by Allah, not a single day had passed, except that he has, you know, to pay more than what he has got. So whatever he's got is not enough to pay back what the people are asking him for. When he died, the Prophet of Allah, he was in love, in debt to that Jewish man for 30 sa'ar. 30 sa'ar, that means you're talking about, you know, a few kilos of kilograms of each sa'ar is about 2 kilos, roughly. So about 60 kilos. You know, for head of the state, he's in debt. Allahu Akbar. He's in debt, yeah. The head of the state these days, he dies, but the whole country will be in debt. As for his virtues, well, he had lots of virtues. Admonishing, advices. Amr al-As, we talked about this when we talked about Ammar ibn Yasir. This incident. When Amr al-As about to die, he started to weep and cry. Abdullah ibn Amr is next to him. And this was in Egypt, because he died in Egypt. And he died in the year, it could be 42, 43, 44 after Hijrah. So he had witnessed the era of Ali and afterwards. Radiallahu anhu. You understand that? Witnessed the era of Ali and afterwards. The era of Muawiyah, Nabi Sufyan. He, radiallahu anhu, started crying and his son is asking him, are you crying? Fearing of death? He said, by Allah, no. But what comes after? So he said to him, verily, father, you are upon good. And he started to remind him of his companionship to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is, the Prophet of Allah is to, you know, come get you closer to him. Alhamdulillah. So he used to tell you to come closer to him. So he said to him, verily, my son, I don't know. Was that because he loved me? Or because he was trying to reconcile and soften my heart? Because I'm a newcomer to the deen. Remember, he became Muslim in the year what? Which year? 8? Which year? 8. Because it was 6 months before the repossession of Mecca. When was the repossession? When was the repossession of Mecca, my dear boy? My dear man? When? Which in eight? Which month of what? Ramadan. The month of what? Ramadan. On which battle? Badr. Right. So in the month of Ramadan, Prophet ﷺ, he entered Mecca. And 6 months before that, he embraced Islam. That is Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu. So he said, I don't know, for verily, was he reconciling my heart because I'm a newcomer to Islam, or was he loved me? But I testify on two men that the Prophet of Allah, he died while he used to love them. Who are they? Ammar ibn Yasir, another one, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. He called them like this, Ibn Sumayya, which is Ammar, and Ibn Ummi Abd, which is Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, the son of Sumayya, and it's Ammar ibn Yasir, and the son of the mother of Abdullah, and that is Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, radiallahu anhu al-jami'a. Also, he said in that moment, when he was crying, when his son is regarding, telling him that, you know, remember what you have done, and you are the one who had conquered Egypt, and you are the one he had even put Egypt back again. He took it back again. So, Abdullah radiallahu anhu, he said, verily, I have left better than this, all of that. Shahadatu an la ilaha illallah. That is a testimony of la ilaha illallah. And I was onto three stages. And each stage I knew of myself how it was. First stage, I was a kafir. And I used to hate the Prophet of Allah. I used to be one of the most hated persons. Although I used to hate the Prophet of Allah the most amongst the people. If I died at that time, I would have been to the hellfire. When I gave pledge to the Prophet of Allah, I used to be the most modest and shy from the Prophet of Allah. I never filled up my eyes from looking to the Prophet. And I never asked him for anything that is due to me because I was shy of him until he died. If I died that day, the people would have said, Hani al-Yam, hooray to Amr. He had died, he had embraced Islam and he was upon good. And if he died, it would have been, that is the hope for Jannah for me. But then after that, I was indulged into Sultan. That is leadership. You understand me? Allah's given him this empowerment. He was empowered by, for example, Umar ibn Khattab to lead. And at the time of Mu'awiyah ibn Sufyan to lead. He said, I don't know, is this for me or against me? So if I die, O Abdullah, do not weep over me. And do not follow me with a person that he would praise me, or he would put fire, because the fire, that means an indication, the man, which is a mighty man, he died. And for verily, make sure that you tie up for my coffin, my shrouds upon me, tie my shroud, for verily, I'm going to be questioned and tested before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And put the sand on top of me, for verily, my right hasn't got the right more than the left, in terms of the sand. I mean, both my side has to be on the sand. And do not put into my grave a piece of wood or a stone. For verily, if you have buried me, sit beside me as much as you slaughter a camel and cut its meat. So I could really have a company of you, the company of you. And this is, by the way, as I said, something that the people forgot about. Is after burying the person to sit in a while with the person, because as I said, his soul will return back and he will feel the company of yours just about 20 minutes, 15 minutes after the burial. Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu wa arda, he is the one he used to say before he died the following words, Allahumma amartana fatalakna. O Lord, you have commanded us to do things, but we left and abandoned. وَنَهَيْتَنَا فَرَكِبْنَا, and you have prohibited us from doing things, but we did it. وَلَا يَسَعُنَا إِلَّا مَغْفِرَتُكَ, and nothing will encompass us except for your forgiveness. That means your forgiveness is that what we need. وَكَانَتْ, this is what had happened, هِجِّرَةً, meaning that those words, is ought to be all the time what he used to say on his tongue before he died. اللهم أمرتنا فتركنا ونهيتنا فركبنا ولا يسعنا إلا مغفرتك. رضي الله عنه وأرضاه. Also, Abdullah ibn Amr al-As narrates to us that my father, he used to say to me, I am so astonished from a man whose death comes to him, and yet he's got his intellect and his tongue and he does not describe it. So when the death came to my father, and he had his intellect and he had his tongue, he said, Father, you used to tell me, I am astonished of a man when death approaches him, yet he's got his tongue and his intellect, yet he does not describe the death. Can you describe the death for me? So he says, dear son, death is greater than to be described, but I'm going to describe some of it to you. For verily, I could just feel that I am almost having a mountain of such and such, and he mentioned two mountains, Ridwa and Tuhama, onto my shoulder, and my soul is about to exit from a hole the size of a needle, and I'm just like having into my throat like a thorn of Awsaq, which is a place, and verily the heavens is almost on top of me, just like it is almost, I'm feeling like if the heavens is onto the earth and I'm between them. Subhanallah. So when Amr ibn Asi died, he's describing to us the moment of Sakarat al-Maut. So we call them the death pens or the death stupors. So those are the said by Allah Azza wa Jalla, وَجَاءَتْ سَكْرَةُ الْمَوْتِ بِالْحَقِّ ذَٰلِكَ مَا كُنْتَ مِنْهُ تَحِيمٍ. And the death pangs came to you, and this is what you're trying to evade and go away from. Right, so Prophet of Allah, he experienced that. When he died, he used to put his hand in the water, and wash his face, wipe his face, لا إله إلا الله إن الموت سكرات. This is Amr ibn al-As, رضي الله عنه وارضاه. And before I go to the following companion, that is Hafsa bint Umar, radiallahu anha, I would like to ask if you have any question regarding Amr ibn al-As. Let's start with your uncle. If you have any question, please, uncle, go ahead. Now. No.
We got only coal water.
No.
And if we have reason to believe, for medical reason, if we use coal water, it's going to harm us.
No. Right, the uncle is asking a question which related to what happened to your boiler, I think, lately. Because you didn't have cold hot water for a long time, isn't it? About how many days? Okay. Yeah. I know that. Somebody is saying that because of what Amr al-Masih has done, is that he had prayed with Janaba, with Tayammum, and he did not wash himself because it was too cold water. Can we take the same thing regarding the issue of that we haven't got hot water in the masjid to make Tayammum because one of the people, like uncle for example himself, because of medical reasons, he can't really have cold water in his bones, maybe arthritis or anything like this. Can he use a tayammum? We can't say that you could use tayammum because there are alternatives. Alternatives, number one, which is you could go home. You don't have to do the jama'ah. So you don't have to do the prayer in the masjid. It's not an excuse for you to pray because you can't miss the jama'ah, you pray tayammum. No, as long as you can really use the water within the time specified, that means you have enough time to go and heat the water, then you're not allowed to pray with them in the masjid. You go home and you heat the water because you've got plenty of time. And if the time is pushing, that's something else. That means if the time is pushing and you don't have time, then we say, yes, we use them, and there is no means to heat the water. So the water, the presence of it is important, and also the ability to use it is important. So if you have the water, but you can't use it, it's like you don't have the water. Okay, some people, even though that they have the ability to, they have the means to heat it, but they can't use it at all because of skin sensitivity, all of that. If it is the case, then they use the tayammum until they are cured, inshallah. So uncle, not them in this masjid, because there's plenty of time. And remember, jama'ah is performed at the beginning of the prayer, meaning that you have plenty of time. The jama'ah is performed at the beginning of the prayer. Even the brightest of all time, which is Maghrib, between Maghrib and Isha, then not much time. Now.
And the second question, you mentioned that all the previous sins are covered, but if you migrate and you embrace Islam,
yeah.
And you do Hajj,
yeah.
Does that mean all your minor and major sins are forgiven when you do Hajj?
Well, uncle, the hadith says you will have, like, you are your mother giving birth to you. I don't think a mother giving birth to you with major sins, uncle, would it? So we leave it like this. Because if you think about it, a person who had stolen, that's a major sin, and he does Hajj, we say that the repentance from that stealing is in the package. Because nobody, unless you want to Hajj to steal as well. That's something else. He went to Hajj in the intention to steal, that's something else. If you want to Hajj in order to have sins forgiven, that is already a repentance from that major sin. That is what it means. Now, Abayd al-Musamit, he did not open Egypt. Amr ibn As, but they were together, but Amr ibn As is the one. So we always say, Mislu Amr, the Egypt of Amr, not Egypt of Abayda.
So he was part of the army?
Part of the army, no. Abayda, what is Abayda? Abayd al-Musamit. Understand the question. Did what, sorry?
When Amr ibn As was the side of Muawiyah, did he take his son that was not the correct?
Amr ibn As, when he was with Muawiyah,
yes.
Did he regret?
It wasn't Abi. Did he confess to his son that was not right?
I have no grasp of a narration like that. But there are lots of narrations which that are under question. Like for example, Amr al-As, he had something against Uthman and Affan. He didn't even like lots of things at the time of Uthman and Affan. I didn't bring that along because verification of that. And plus, we say as Shaykh Islam ibn Taymiyyah, what happened in between the companions, okay, regarding the dispute. Number one, we hold our tongue. We say only the good. Number two, whatever it is that's been mentioned, either is some of it is not authentic, some of it being added to it, some of it is being subtracted from it, and what is authentic is very little. And in it, the companions either mushtahidun musibun, that means they are made ijtihad and they were correct, two double ajr, or they are mushtahidun mukhti'un, one ajr, that means they made ijtihad, but they're wrong, they one ajr. But those companions, if they did something wrong, they have done lots of, you know, hasanat and reward, that those hasanat are enough to expiate those sins, and their closeness to the Prophet of Allah is enough to expiate these sins. So their minor, you know, defects with sins and is in the ocean of their virtues. So as I said, I didn't mention all of these things. I didn't mention a number of issues regarding Amr al-As, which is being mentioned against him. But Amr al-As, if you want to mention him. Na'mal malu salih li rajul salih. Good money is good for good. He said salih. So he mentioned it to be what? Righteous man, rajulun salih. Any person who had, see, those Rafidah and those who hate the companions, like Tawbat al-Halabi, he said, the scholar, that the barrier of the companions is Muawiyah ibn Sufyan. Okay, soon as they go into Muawiyah, they step into Muawiyah and they go over top of him. They go into whom? Amr ibn al-As. Amr ibn al-As is the second after that. That is when you go into him. أما من مالك الباب فقد دخل. And he who enters that, then he had entered. And he will start insulting and insulting. And then he will talk about Umar and Abu Bakr رضي الله عنهما. نعم. تفضل.
So is it correct the narration that says Umar ibn al-As son, he wronged somebody and Umar ibn al-Khattab, he heard about it?
His narration says that Umar al-Khattab رضي الله عنه, he brought Umar al-As and his son because of a Christian man. And he beat them up and he hit them on their heads. That's not authentic. Okay, they didn't bring that as well along. But we know Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he would hit him because he had hit his son. He would hit him. I mean, the narration, if it's not authentic, but we know that Umar al-Khattab, in terms of justice, لا تأخذوا في الله لو مات الآن. No way. And he had beaten, remember, Sabir ibn Usul, he had beaten him. He put him in the Arajin al-Nakhir, he put him, he said, I've heard that you're saying something regarding the Mutashabih al-Qur'an, these issues. If you got any problems, okay, so he beat him up. You got any problems? He said, no, everything's evaporated from my head. Got no problem on my head. But that was a person, he needed that beaten up. Okay, that's his Umar al-Khattab. So but that narration, I didn't bring it along as well. See, we have to be careful regarding the narrations, as I mentioned, Salman al-Farisi regarding Salman bin al-Bayt, that stuck to my archive in my knowledge, but I know it inside it is not authentic. But I know that it is authentic in terms of sound-wise. Meaning of it is authentic. We Salman radiallahu anhu, in terms of, we are from al-Bayt. Aren't we? We are from al-Bayt. But when you say al-Bayt specifically, that means the lineage, we're not. But in terms of, when we say Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad, we are entering as well in that. Okay? We enter in that as well because we are the people who champion. So we dissociate ourselves from the Rawafid who speak ill about the companion and from the Nawasib who speak ill against the relatives of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The two ways are, 180 degrees. We are in the middle. We give to the companions what we give. We don't need them to be prophets. And we as well say that they are not ma'sumun, they're not really infallible, just like the Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, and Al-Hasan and Hussein and Fatima, those are the ones we call them the people of the Kisa, which the Prophet threw a Kisa on them and recited the verse onto them. وَطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. So we believe in that, but we don't believe that, for example, that they are what the Shia say about them. رضي الله عنه وارضاه. نعم. نعم تفضل.
نعم.
This مبتدا خبر. If you understand Arabic, I don't know. So that was حال and this is حال. وامرأة حمالة. This is the one in the explanation. حمالة means like we saw it, حال, صفة, حال, it's منصوب. Alright? No. مبتدا خبر. Okay. حمالة. مرفوعة, مرفوعة. حمالة. هي, she. حمالة is the ta for the female. No, ta مربوطة. First of all, Hamad, both of them, Hamalat al Hatam. Hamalat, there's no term of Sultan. There's no term of Sultan, there's term of Sultan. Hamala, Hamal, Hamala. Okay? There's no term of Sultan at all in this word. Hamalat al Hatam. Bin Hamala, Yahmil, Hamala means he carries. Alright? Now. Any question? And then shall I go to Hafsa? Okay, Hafsa radiallahu anha. Hafsa bint Umar. And Hafsa bint Umar, we have discussed Umar al-Khattab in his narration and his lineage. She is from the Banu Adi. Banu Adi ibn Ka'b. And she and her mother, she had as well Abdullah ibn Umar, her brother. And the mother of her and Abdullah is called Zainab bint Mad'un. And she is the sister of Uthman al-Mad'un, the Prophet ﷺ, when he died, he came to him and he had kissed him and he was crying. Uthman ibn Mad'un, he is Ni'ma al-Salaf. He's a Salaf. Radiallahu anhu. So Uthman ibn Mad'un, when he died, Prophet ﷺ, he cried. And that is his, the Uthman ibn Mad'un is the maternal uncle of Hafsa. Hafsa, she was from the migrators, and she was before the Prophet of Allah with somebody called Khunais ibn Hudhat al-Sahami, and he's a person who had witnessed the Battle of Badr, and he died in the Medina. When Hafsa, she became a widow, Umar al-Khattab, he mentioned her to Abu Bakr in order if he wants to marry her, but Abu Bakr did not give him a decisive answer. So Umar, he was really enraged. He didn't say to him, yes or no. So he just said, go on, let me just go and ask Uthman. So he went to Uthman, and Uthman radiallahu anhu, he had his wife, the daughter of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ruqayya, had just died. So his Uthman, he said, I don't want to marry today. That means I'm not feeling myself, I want to marry. So Umar al-Khattab, he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he had complained regarding Uthman. So the Prophet you know, somebody will marry Hafsa better than Uthman. And he himself, he married her. He asked for her. When he married her, when he had asked for her, Abu Bakr came to Umar, he said, I know that you are annoyed for me. Because I said to you nothing. But I've heard the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioning your daughter in a way that maybe he wants to marry her. And I'm not going to disclose the secret of the Prophet of Allah. So I thought if he wanted her, he would have gone to you. If he didn't want her, I will come to you and marry her. So the Prophet of Allah did not marry her, I would have married her myself. So here, Abu Bakr, he made sure that he will clear any misconception or anything hatred into heart of Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu warda. So she was married to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, according to the scholars, the year 3 after Hijrah. So first wife was? Second one? Third one? Fourth one? Hafsa. Right, okay. That's in the order. Hafsa. So again, mention them again. For the sisters. First one, Khadija. Second one, Sauda. Straight after her was Aisha. So Sauda and then Aisha. After. So Khadija, Sauda, Aisha, and then Hafsa bint Umar radiallahu anha. Right. This Hafsa radiallahu anha, she's one as well from the party of Aisha. Min Hizb Aisha. And Sauda and Aisha and Hafsa and Safiya, they were from the Hizb of Aisha. And the rest, all of them, the Hizb of Zainab, Salam and the rest. Hizb. That means they're two, like the co-wives, and then they ally with each other. Hizb. Right. And this is what the companion said. That's not us. She's Aisha, she said to him. My Hizb and her, their Hizb. So she's on her side. Hafsa, she's the one, if you remember, she was with Aisha. When Aisha, she came to her, when she saw the Prophet ﷺ used to eat and drink the honey in the presence of Zainab. So they said to her, each other, let's just say, as soon as he comes to you, I'm going to say the same thing. We smell from you maghafir, like garlic smell. You know, that means the honey that you have drank, maybe that the bees were onto garlic. They brought it, you know. And as soon as he comes to you, he says the same thing. So they're both together. They cooperated to say this, you know. Anyway, as soon as the Prophet ﷺ, he had these words from Aisha and then Hafsa, the same thing. He said, by Allah, I am not going to eat that honey at all. I'm not going to drink that honey at all. And that's when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mentioned surah and the verses regarding this issue, in which also Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu wa arda, he didn't like what his daughter was doing. One day, Umar ibn Khattab is explaining to us, he said, and if I want to mention this story, it's going to take me a bit of time. It's a long story, but I'll cut it short as much as I can. Umar Khattab, he said, when we were in Quraysh, the man, he's the dominant. His opinion, it goes through. No argumentation from the women. But when we came to the Medina, it was something else. The women of the Medina, they have power. Okay? So they have like, they have sayings. And as soon as I said something to my wife, raja'atni, that means she's like saying she's not really happy with what I... So he's just shouted at her, what are you doing? How can you, how dare you to argue with me regarding something? You should have just said quietly. He said to her, why are you so upset for me, trying to maybe not to negotiate regarding an issue where the wives of the Prophet of Allah, your daughter, she as well, not accepting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what he's saying. You see, is this right true? Oh, that's too much. Wallahi, she's gonna be finished. So straight away he couldn't really hold himself and he went dressed up and he went to the Prophet, to the daughter of his, and he entered. He said, I've heard such and such to Raji'ina, did you really, for example, and also you don't really, I've heard that you don't sleep as well. You prevent it from, the woman punishing the man, I'm not gonna give you what you want. Is that true? And Layla wa Laylata, she said, yes. She said, verily, aren't you scared that Allah will get angry from you because you are making the Prophet of Allah angry? Aren't you scared from that? Don't be jealous because of that girl, the other one, she is more beautiful than you. Huh? He's talking about Aisha. Don't be jealous because the other woman is more beautiful than you. They're going to put you in trouble. They're going to put you in trouble. So anyway, the story, as I said, long story, if I want to mention it, I will read it for you. But the thing is that Prophet of Allah, he had divorced him. And Umar Khattab anticipated all of that. And he, at the end of the story, he went to the Prophet of Allah, the Prophet of Allah smiled. And the hadith ends up with the hadith that we have explained in your Adab al-Mufrad, which Umar Khattab entered on the Prophet of Allah, and he found him onto that bed, which is made of, the leaves of the paper of the palm tree, and he was making a mark on his side, and he said, Kisra and all those kings, they sleep on something nice, and you sleep on this. Wallahi, you are more deserved than this. He said, Ya Umar, أَمَا تَرْضَى أَنَّ لَهُمُ الدُّنْيَا وَنَرَى الْآخِرَةَ. Aren't you satisfied that they have the dunya and we have the akhirah? And he started crying. He started crying. So anyway, he gave a divorce and then Prophet of Allah brought him back again. She is one of those women, Hafsa, that she had the divorce, and Allah sent him Jibreel alayhi salam to command him to what? To return the wives of his. And one of them, as I said, is Hafsa radiallahu anha wa ardaha. In terms of stories about Hafsa, there are not plenty of them, authenticity-wise. But we know that Hafsa radiallahu anha wa ardaha, that she was sawwamatun qawwama. She was sawwama qawwama. That means she used to fast and she used to pray the night as well. And also, we know from her that she is the one whom Umar al-Khattab, he left the Mus'haf with her. Umar al-Khattab, he left the Mus'haf with her. And Uthman ibn Affan, when he had people entering the religion from different counties, and they started making mistakes, and people can't correct the mistakes, believing they are from the recitations of the Qur'an, that is why he decided to bring back that Mus'haf from Hafsa, and to make another copy, other copies, and all the other copies to be burnt. Why? Because the personal copies of those people used to have writings as well on them. So he burnt all these copies, and he made the master copy from the copy of Hafsa, and he made about 6 copies. He sent them to the provinces at that time, and he ordered that everybody to adhere to that, and it was in the Lahjat Quraysh, which we call it the articulation of, or the accent of Quraysh, Lahjat Quraysh. She died in the year 41, Wallahu A'lam, radiallahu anha wa ardaha. She died in the year 41, that means just after the assassination of Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiallahu anhu wa ardaha. That's Hafsa for you, inshallah. And we'll have now questions for a general Hafsa or anybody else. Now.
Sure, is that narration correct about Ibn Umar, that his father told him when his camel's been given the water by, because he said, sell it and so on, he told him off? Is that correct?
Remind me the story, because it rings a bell, but remind me the story properly. Umar al-Khattab, he said to his son?
His son told him that his camel and did the stuff. They drank the water quicker and so on, and he said, because they gave you, because you are the son of the Amir al-Mu'mineen.
Oh yeah, you mean Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, when he gave him and his brother. That's an authentic story, we discuss it in the book of Jihad, if you remember. Is that the one? He gave them money, and that money they have invested into it. And he said to them, had it been, would he give you the money if you were? Is that the story? Authentic? Yes. Yeah, authentic. That story is authentic. We discussed it and we said that how Umar, we're not discussing whether the story of Umar, nor is it the story of Abdullah ibn Umar. So this is not to. That's right. Correct. All in authentic. 100%. No.
It's about Salat. If a person misses the rukuh of the second rak'ah of Jumu'ah, does he pray four?
If a person misses the rukuh of the second rak'ah of the Salat of Jumu'ah, does he pray four rak'ah? Now this is a dispute among the scholars. Al-Jumhur, they say that the person who misses the rukuh of the second rak'ah, whether he is intentionally or not intentionally, then he has to pray four rak'ah. And this is the saying of Abdullah ibn Umar, and also the saying of Mu'awiyah ibn Sufyan, and the saying of other companions, and it stems from the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, Man adraka rak'atan min al-jum'ah, fa adraka as-salah. He catches up with one rak'ah of the jum'ah, he caught up with the salah. That means, if you didn't catch up with one rak'ah, you did not catch up with the salah. And also on the hadith, he who had caught up with one rak'ah of the Jumu'ah, they let him add to another rak'ah. Add to it, another rak'ah. And he did not catch up with rak'ah, that means he did not catch up with the salah. As for the praying four, this is the Jumhur Ahl al-Ilm, you say praying four. But we do have a fiqh from some of the students of knowledge, Sheikh Mashur, hafizahullah. Now they differentiate between two people. One person who is the one who has keen to come to the Jumu'ah, and he missed. Now regardless what he missed, he will pray it. So if he even caught up with the last tashahud, he makes what? Two rak'ah. And as for the person who did not, the one who did not really keen to come to the Jumu'ah, this is the one who had missed the Jumu'ah, then even if he prays four, which he's supposed to, it will not be accepted until he repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if he caught up with one rak'ah, then he caught up with the Jumu'ah, then he could pray a rak'ah. Otherwise, it's not going to be acceptable. He prays four, but he repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the Jumu'ah is finished. Wallahu a'lam. First, last sajda for the first rak'ah?
First sajda.
Or the first, last rak'ah?
The last rak'ah.
No, you got confused, I think.
The fajr?
No. You're talking about a person who had delayed his prayer to the last seconds of sunset, okay, or sunrise, and deliberately. Then if you caught up with the first sajda, or the first rak'ah, not the last rak'ah, then he caught up with the prayer, that means he could continue. If he did not catch up with the first sajda, the first rak'ah, then the prayer is finished. There's no prayer for him. It's invalid. So he made the first sajda within the time, but that is for somebody who is not having a legitimate excuse. If you have a legitimate excuse, you pray even after the sunrise. It doesn't matter. Now.
Hafsa's height, and the Prophet said, if you approach with
Safiyya, not Hafsa. Yes, Safiyya, hadith sahih, but not Hafsa. Safiyya, we haven't really talked about her yet. She was short. لقد قلت كلمة لم موجز بماء البحر لم زيت. نعم. You said a word that if you to be mixed up with the sea water, that would have been polluted it. نعم. Correct. فضل. Right. First of all, alhamdulillah that you are, alhamdulillah, in the right part, and you are in the right religion, and your Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had saved you from worshipping many gods, to worship Him alone, not to worship idols or statues, because you come from that background. And I ask Allah Azza wa Jal to keep your religion preserved, so to be better and better, bi-idhnillah. What I would like to ask is, one of your family is Muslims or just in your own?
Yeah.
Are you living with your parents?
They are back home in India.
And they don't know about your Islam?
Yes.
And what did they say?
Because of me, you know, I'm Muslim now, my mom had the operation of brain operation, you know, 2-3 months ago.
Mm.
Because she's taking so much tension.
Because of your Islam?
Yeah.
She had operation in her brain because he became Muslim.
Yeah. She took so much tension.
And your father?
Father is okay. I just spoke to him.
And he's okay with that?
Inside he is. No, but
okay. Be careful from the magic. And be careful to go to India. And if you went there, make sure they don't really eat anything or drink anything. Because I know from my experience, people came from the same background, Hindus, and became, mashallah, from the Sunnah, and you know, the Salafis, and with the beards and everything, and then suddenly they left. Because their mothers, or their fathers, or their relatives made magic onto them. Because they are into that land of magic.
I went there after.
May Allah protect you. But I'm just saying, be careful what you eat or what you drink. Because magic is something that Allah told us about, and we need to be aware of it. Okay. To preserve your religion, remember that when you become a Muslim, Shaitan, he will direct now most of his soldiers to you.
Yeah.
Of course. Once you're a Hindu, he will leave you, khalas. You are, you know, it's not customary anymore. That's it, it's finished. But once you start becoming the deen, that's when he send you now soldiers after soldiers, reporters after reporters, what have you done to him, what have you done to him. And the life's pleasures and the life's entertainment and the life's as well dangers are too many. And every single person of us here is exactly having the same thing like you. Okay? So don't you ever think that we're not vulnerable. We're vulnerable as well to the fitna. Maybe we're not as vulnerable to the fitna of the deen than the vulnerable to the fitna of the dunya. Okay? But the most thing that you really should really care of is the strike into your deen, the fitna of your deen. So that you don't have shubuhat, that you're going to go back to worship Rama and Krishna and all of that.
I was not doing it before.
You know? Do you have any sort of doubts regarding God 1 and 1, God 3 and 4? Or this is finished now?
What?
I mean, do you think that you are vulnerable, that you could go back to your religion? No. But you are talking about maybe the mistake that when you look at naked women or something like this, that Iman goes down, your faith goes down. Is that what you're worried about?
Yeah, it becomes
well, that's a good thing, alhamdulillah. Al-ithmu ma haka fi sadr wa khashita an yattali alayhi an-nas. Well, we say the sin is what something bothers you in the heart, and you're scared that the people, you fear that the people will know about it. And this is really good. So it's a good sign, don't worry about that. Color of blood is not about white or green or what?
Like you mentioned now, the person accepted Islam, he becomes like a born baby.
Yes.
Alhamdulillah.
Let me just now help you to, as you said, the question is, how can I preserve myself? Yeah. You are at the moment with us, your iman goes up. As soon as you leave that door, all of us are saying anything, your iman goes down. I mean, this is, yeah, it goes up and down, alhamdulillah. Just like your car, you know, your car, you run on full fuel all the time, isn't it? Fuel's gonna go down. So you go to the petrol station, fill up. The petrol station for your heart is your brothers, is the masjid, the Quran, it's petrol stations. We are up and down. Who says to you that we are not sinful people? We are. Wallahi, the sins have to have a smell. I'm saying to you, none of us will stay and withstand to sit with each other. No way. Look at this. You stink, brother. But alhamdulillah, Allah had hidden for us to steal their sins. The time of Banu Israel, any person makes something during the night, it would be written on his door the following day. What a shame. What a shame. Everything, what you've done. So now alhamdulillah, Allah had hidden for us our sins. So, this is what I say to you. One day, Hanbalah, one of the companions, he left the Prophet ﷺ and went to his kids. And he started joking with his kids and his wife. And he said, oh my God, what is Lama doing here? So he went outside shouting, Nafaqa Hanbalah, Nafaqa Hanbalah. Hanbalah is a hypocrite, Hanbalah is a hypocrite. Abu Bakr met him. What's wrong with Hanbalah? Why are you saying this? He said, verily, when we are with the Prophet of Allah, just like you are at the moment here, we mention hellfire and paradise, we mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're just like with Allah azza wa jal, just like we're living in paradise, we're as far as we can from hellfire. And as soon as we leave the Prophet of Allah, we go to the house, we are with the spouse, with the wife, and the children, the dunya and all of that. This is called hypocrisy. So Abu Bakr said, well, I'm a hypocrite as well. I'm not different from you. Same thing. Let's go to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you want to ask the Prophet of Allah, Messenger of Allah? This is what is happening. We are with you. MashaAllah. Close to Jannah. You go to the women and children. Our iman goes down. He said, Ya Hamza, if you stay the same thing as you were with me all the time, the angels will come and shake your hands, which is going to be impossible. Do you understand what does that mean? That means, can you have angels now say, I am Jibreel alayhi salam, I am Mikael alayhi salam, I am. They're going to be shaking your hands. But this isn't going to happen. That means if you're going to stay 24 hours like this, angel will come to you and there's no way. It is impossible. But sa'a wa sa'a ya Allah. Meaning sa'a for Allah Azza wa Jal. Another time for dunya, but according to what Allah told us. It is not like people say sa'a for Allah and sa'a for sinning. Sa'a wa sa'a. Sa'a rabbak, sa'a qalbak. 1 hour for Allah, 1 hour for your heart. Go and enjoy yourself. It doesn't mean that. 1 hour is for Allah Azza wa Jal, means the prayership and the ibad and all that. And 1 hour, that is to do things which we need to survive. Can you survive without food, brother? You can't. Can you survive without drink? You can't. You can't survive on your own. You say, I'm not going to meet anybody. No, I'm not going to speak. I'm not going to be talking. This is not life. So that is what the companions had done at the time of Umar al-Khattab. As soon as there's a horse giving birth from a little horse, they go and slaughter it. But what have you heard? What is this? He said, well, we're not going to live to ride it. He said, no, do for your dunya. Zahrat al-hayat al-dunya. He said, وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. Allah says, don't forget your portion from the dunya. But بِالْحَلَال, halal, halal. So don't worry about that. As long as you are with a brother. So if it's coming to your heart and hurt, mashallah. What is wrong is that you see something haram and nothing happens here. And nothing goes into the ear, guys. But don't be as well. The shaitan comes to you sometimes as a sheikh. Be careful. Shaitan comes to you in the form of a nice sheikh. Yeah. And it makes you cry a bit more until you become something else. Be careful. And it makes you in despair of the mercy of Allah. So be careful. Yeah, but you are maybe having information more than somebody who was born as a Muslim for 15, 16 years. Wallah. What about maybe you're reading now? You ever think you are behind the Muslims, all of them better than you? You would be surprised. There's so many Muslims are names, just names, Muslims, but they haven't read about their religion. They haven't even read some of the Quran. They haven't. So take it easy, inshallah. And I ask Allah to protect you, but all the time, be with the brothers. The brothers and the company is very important. As-sahibu sahib. The company will pull you, either to hellfire or to paradise. Remember that. And you're targeted, by the way. Shaitan targeting you as well, and your family targeting you.
Next day, yeah. I tell you, the question I was not thinking about.
And be careful, the last thing, is the last thing, inshallah, brother, will stop. The websites. Websites that are websites will throw doubts into your heart. Very importantly, because I know some people had committed apostasy and left the religion. They were Christian, became Muslim, and became atheist now. The last thing I'm going to tell you is a story to everybody. It happened to the Jumu'ah, just like Jumu'ah when I finished my khutbah. As soon as I left, and I wanted to leave as quickly as possible, but I'm having people to ask, and they were delaying me. And I was a bit just not really happy, because I've got an appointment, but I can't push the people away. And I left in the car, and Allah Azza wa Jalla sent me this sister. And this is from Ibtila. I've got an appointment, and this sister, if you don't ask me now, she approached me with a little kid, and she started crying. I'm just going to put the ignition on, switch it off. Yes, sister. She said, can I ask you something? I said, it's too cold here, come to the masjid. She went inside the masjid, put in a room and a different room and talking to her through the barrier. Yes, sister. And it took about half an hour, in which she was crying and crying. She was a Christian, based Islam about 2 years ago. Okay? And now she's having things. She said, I'm having things. I said, what is it? She said, something, she can't even say it. I said, I know. Is it something that you can't say it? Like, for example, is Allah exist? Who's before Allah? Great. Did it come to you? Yes. He said, Alhamdulillah, don't worry. Why are you crying? Companions came to the Prophet and said, Masjid Allah, there are things in ourselves. Inna ahadana la yata'adhamu an yaqula. It's really too much for us to go and say it. وَلَقَدْ وَجَدْتُمُوهُ Did you find it? Said, yes, Masjid Allah. ذَلِكَ صَلِيحُ الْإِيمَانِ This is the clear cut of iman that the shaitan sending new things to put down into what you already believe. So if you kicked him out, alhamdulillah, don't worry about it. But then he comes again with something. How was it, brother? I haven't finished. So, and then she comes again with something else. And that is, she said, well, you know, there's something that is bothering me. What is it? This is coming to the websites. She said, the ayah, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, translation of which, that is, وَأَلْقَى فِيهَا رَوَاسِي And he had sent into it anchors, the mountains. And تَمِيدَ بِكُمْ That it will sway into you. So, I'm having doubt about that. Who will put the doubt into you? Who will put the doubt into you? Until we found out that it is a website, a professor. That the Allah, if you put about talking about mountains, Rawasi, and the mountains are, the more mountains, that means the more probability of earthquake. There's no link, brothers, between earthquakes and mountains. You have to put that ayah, he came to them to say there will be no earthquakes. That's not true. If it is true, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how is it at the end of the day he talks about the qal, إِذَا زُلْزِلَتِ الْأَرْضُ زِلْزَالَ So zilzal, so it's good, it will have earthquakes. Who said that the mountains, they are on the earth to stop the earthquake? That's not right. Anchors is not to, that means it will slip from underneath you. It's nothing to do with earthquake. And if we haven't really reached in our science to interpret such a verse, let's stick to the interpretation of what the verse says. Just like Ibn Kathir, what did he say about this verse? And I started quoting here too what Ibn Kathir had said. I just held the book and read out what Ibn Kathir says. So at the moment the science did not discover that, don't worry about it. The anchor and all of that. Then I said to her, didn't you have more facts that Allah exists? She said, yes. So if you had no doubt about Allah Azza wa Jalla, and you had a verse or more than one verse which you did not have the proper interpretation, what should you do with your mind? Submit or start arguing? Nusallim ya akhi. Do you know about the punishment of the grave? Do you submit? Okay, you show me what is the punishment of the grave. Yeah, you tell me. Are you going to tell me you're going to put a Bluetooth device there and you're going to listen or a CCTV camera and see what is the punishment of the grave? No way. You believe in it, don't you? Yes. But you can't see it. Just like a person who's sleeping next to you. And this person, he wakes up, he says, oh Allah, I was in Japan. Brother, in Japan, you're next to me. Just Allah, I was had a ticket and I'm one flying with a visa. Oh, mashallah. So in his dream, he felt he came to Japan and went back from Japan and all of that, and yet he's next to you. True? A person wakes up, terrified, what's happening? Beast was following you. Brother, it would not be so. You are on top of you're not in the Amazon jungle. No, you're next. But he felt truly in the jungle and a beast following him and all of that. So if we believe in that dream, We don't believe that Allah will make you to experience the punishment, proper punishment, while you are in the grave. So we, in our limited mind, which has the limited limbs, which is eyes and seeing and all of that, limited mind, we cannot interpret something about the ghaib, the unseen. We could believe in it, but with our brain obedient, but what our brain, we cannot really envision it at the moment. Can't see it. This is different from Krishna or Rama stories. Submit to it where it does contradict. There's no contradiction. And that is why we say in our Islam, there is nothing in the science would contradict the text from the Quran and Sunnah. And nothing in the Quran and the Sunnah will contradict anything in the dunya if it's been proved scientifically. Nothing. There will no be contradiction. As the contradiction in other books is obvious. Like for example in the Bible, the first verses, when it talks about day and night before the creation of the sun. How can it be? Allah put day and night and then He made the sun. I mean, that's a contradiction from the first beginning. Ram, Mr. Ram, how can they say, for example, don't eat meat and he's got an arrow? What is he doing, hunting trees with arrows? True or not? A contradiction is obvious. He's got arrows and hunting what, trees? Or for example, he lost his wife and then he asked him, oh Lord, well, he's a Lord himself. How can a Lord ask another Lord? You look into that story of Rama, it's a story. It's not from Allah. It's made up, even made up by simple men. It's not even made up by clever men, because you can find lots of contradiction into it. I mean, it's not as clever as Paul, the one who written that story of Krishna and Rama. I mean, Hanuman, you know, the monkey garden. Yeah, you know, he's writing a piece of a stone, he's writing the word Rama, and he put it on the water, and he went, you know, he passed on to Sri Lanka. So he have more faith in the God himself. Because he's telling God, you have no faith. Because Rama is more clever than the Hanuman. If you put that stone there, you're going to drown. He said, no, put Rama where it float. And the whole army went from India to Sri Lanka. When you look at the story, you said, really somebody in this century would believe such a thing? But in the Islam, there are things which are from the ghaib. Took in Allah Azza wa Jalla, the punishment of the grave, in the hereafter, in the Jannah. That you didn't see. But something in the dunya, everything goes along. Everything. The embryo now is the best for you, the scientific thing. You know the embryo. Have you seen it? That's the mind-blowing. Wallah. If you look at it, you know this is from Allah.
No, I don't have.
No, I'm not talking about you, brother. I'm talking about, don't worry about it. So, you have any questions now? Subhanakallah, bihamdika, shukran, astaghfirullah.